Coming up next is a power panel. The topic for discussion is contemporary discourses in gender-based development work. The panel consists of Lakshmi Puri, former Assistant Secretary General, United Nations, Mario Pezzini, Director of OECD, and Pradeep Nair, Regional Director of Skoll Foundation. The moderator for the session is Nandita Baruah, who is a country representative, India,
at so we decided
at the Asia Foundation. At Asia Foundation. She has headed South Asia regional programs on gender-based violence, human trafficking, and migration and rural development. She worked as a gender advisor to the CIDA in India and also as a South Asia regional gender fund manager. She was a regional coordinator for the UN Women Anti-Trafficking Program and the UNODC UN Gift Program. Over to you, Nandita, now. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pooja, for the introduction. I think that was really way beyond a lot what I've done. Thank you so much. So we have a very powerful, as Pooja pointed out, we have extremely power-packed panel today that we are going to be talking about a very, very important issue, which is called the contemporary discourses in gender-based development work. The three panelists that we have today with us are Lakshmi Puri, Pradeep Nair, and Mario. So I'm going to start off by giving a quick introduction to the three panelists. Welcome, Lakshmi. As Pooja pointed out, Lakshmi Puri is a former Assistant Secretary General at the United Nations and the former Deputy Executive Director of the UN Women. Lakshmi has actually been at, leading with a lot of flagship programs. She is also the director of the flagship International Trade Division and the Acting Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations Trade Conference on Trade and Development. She's been at the forefront of some very, very critical movements and campaign like the He for She and Planet 50-50 with the global impact. So Lakshmi, we are really pleased to have you with us. A warm welcome to you. The second panelist is Pradeep Nair. Pradeep has over 25 years of experience in this sector of development, but also actually comes from a very strong technology and IT background. He started in the Silicon Valley as a Big Five management consultant, building software applications and products. And then after a stint with technology, actually, Pradeep moved to startups, and he moved to New York to be an advisory to the startup led by President Clinton and Mayor Bloomberg. Of course, this led to many other challenging and interesting early startup opportunities, including joining with Paul Volcker, which focused on financial sector and academy and government. Currently, Pradeep heads the Ford Foundation, which is one of the largest and the oldest private foundation in the region. And Ford actually has been at the forefront of many critical interventions on gender, promoting gender equity and social inclusion. Our third panelist for today is Mr. Mario Pezzini. Welcome, Mario.
Good evening.
Good evening. Mario is the director of the OECD Development Centre, and he served as an acting director of the OECD Development Corporation Directorate, and he has been nominated as a special advisor to the OECD Secretary General. Prior to joining OECD, Mario has an illustrious career in academics. He was actually a professor in industrial economics at various universities, including the Ecole Nationale at Paris in US and in Italy. He's also served as an advisor to various think tanks and international organizations like the ILO, UNIDO, European Commission, on issues related to regional economics, economic development, and gender. So Mr. Pezzini, welcome again, and really pleased to have you. So with this extremely illustrious panel, we're going to start our discussion, and I am going to put my first question to you, Lakshmi. So, we're talking about this contemporary discourse in gender-based development work. And I think it's been a while since we have had the Beijing, conference and the post that the 2030 agenda. A lot of issues have happened. Many countries have made many commitments. There are many legal frameworks and policies. What would be interesting to know is that despite very robust legal frameworks sometimes, and despite a very strong civil society presence, there still seems to be many roadblocks to women's empowerment and equity issues. What do you think could be some of the things that the government could do better in terms of better monitoring, better focused on, you know, actually implementing the laws and policies that are on ground to enable the empowerment and equity that we are seeking, Nalini. So over to you, Nalini.
Thank you, Nandita. And it's wonderful to get together with all of you representing institutions that we have worked with. I have worked with when I was with UN Women and with other parts of the UN. So it's, and also, of course, on this 15th August, 73rd Independence Day, it's very important to talk about gender-based development work. And in a country like India, which is complex, which is diverse, which has so many socio-economic challenges, and the scale of it, the sheer scale of it is so much, that we really need to look at gender equality and women's empowerment issues in its very composite sense. And I for one feel that government in a country like India, government has a central role to deliver the public good of gender equality and women's empowerment, and also deliver public goods to women. So this is the context in which you are absolutely, how do we translate and download the global norms and standards that have been established over the last many years, and more especially, you referred to Beijing, but after that also, and now we have the Agenda 2030 Sustainable Development Goals, and there is SDG 5, and then there are 11 other SDGs that cover areas such as poverty, health, education, housing, energy, wash, decent work, economic growth, food security and nutrition. So all of these areas now, there are these commitments that governments have made to achieve SDGs for women and girls. So you asked, how should it be more effectively implemented? There are three imperatives, first of all, when we talk about, you know, because let's focus on programs and interventions. So there are three imperatives when we are looking at women empowering programs or development programs or their human rights programs. So one is to have dedicated, customized, targeted programs for women. And of course, I always say by women and of women. So that is something that is very important to have alongside, because there are sometimes, you know, these discourses that, you know, you don't need women specific programs, you can do with transversal programs. But then the second category is to have transversal programs that gender mainstream and that make it very gender responsive in every important development mission, transversal program undertaken to achieve the SDGs. So that's the second. And then the third aspect is to have there are certain prerequisites for effectiveness. How do you implement them? And that's your question. So the first thing is to have data, gender disaggregated data, information, analysis, to have knowledge hubs on what are the issues, what are the structural barriers, how to demolish them, and how to then positively provide the access and to enable women to exercise their rights, whether it's right to work, to right to education, and so on, and right to dignity and life free of violence. The second is, of course, human resource deployment. And here I think it's very important that women are not only seen as beneficiaries, but as the agents of development. And women as a resource to be developed as human capital. I think these are very important aspects. The other aspect is advocacy, awareness raising, and movement building, particularly in an area like this, which needs social norm overhaul and change and mindset change. and which is very deep-seated, patriarchies, the patriarchal mindset and the iniquitous mindset that is so difficult to change unless you do really very aggressive advocacy and awareness raising and movement building. And then of course the infrastructure, the physical infrastructure, the social infrastructure, the tools, the equipment that you need to provide to in regard to various programs. And then partnerships with women's organizations is critical, the self-help groups, the grassroots women's organization at every level. I think women's organizations, you mentioned them, but they are really very, very important. And then nothing moves without finance. We often find some of these programs are underfinanced or not properly integrated into finance. So what we call transformative financing for women's empowerment. And then very quickly, I want to cover also this whole partnerships with sectoral, local stakeholders, including private sector. Local government is very important. You know, that's where the rubber hits the ground. And of course, civil society is very, very important, including of women. And then intersectionality, integration, targeted, and women and their transformation not being an incidental or an afterthought in how you design programs, how you implement programs. Just some examples I would like to give, Nandita, of some of these things and how the government has indeed approached this. Now, PM Modi's emphasis, as we see it, is that it's on gender equality and women's empowerment transformation through women-led development rather than just development of women. And in that sense, center staging women in development as agents of change. And this means that empowering her becomes the axis around which the entire sectoral development hinges. And I'll just give you one example of the urban mission on housing for all, the PM in Nepal. Now, if you look at that program, and I'll come to Beti Bachao in a minute. If you look at that program, what has happened is that the urban mission is a transversal mission, but it has set very clear conditions that government support for housing for all, particularly for the economically weak and middle class beneficiaries, will have to be in the name of the woman of the house. So that has meant 75% of the beneficiaries on an average, some of them are 98%. I mean, there are four categories of these beneficiaries are women. So that's a transformation. And, you know, women are leading that transformation in housing for all. Similarly, if you look at a gender-specific targeted program like Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, and although it has no feet in terms of, you know, brick and mortar impact, but it is doing something very, very important, which is changing social norms. This girl aversion, boy preference, and also the valuing of girls so that you invest in their education, you make them economically empowered. So I think that has had an impact in changing the sex ratio in all of the districts, you know, where, and I have some statistics here, 104 out of 161 districts showed improved sex ratio at birth, maternal care, and institutional deliveries. And then also increasing girls' enrollment in schools from even 10% from 2016 to 2018. So there is this mindset change, behavior change, and social norm change that also programs can build around and leverage. The third is, of course, this gender responsive budgeting. I don't want to go into details, but again, there have been some steps taken. What perhaps some programs need is scaling up. And one program which I would very much like to see scaled up are these one-stop crisis centers for supporting women who are victims of violence. So these are some of the things that really we need to pick up the best success stories and build upon. But of course, there's much to do, and every mission, whether it is digital, Skill India, every education, the new education policy, everything must have a very strong gender focus as well as financial investment in that. So that's something that will really make a difference.
Thank you so much, Lakshmi. I think critical points you talked about. One, definitely dedicated programs which are led by women, where women have an agency. Huge investments that government need to do, because scalability is something that only governments are best placed to do, but they need to be done in collaboration and partnership with those that whose lives we are trying to change. So clearly women's led organization, women's voices, very critical to it. And creating a movement. And I think what's interesting is you pointed out to two things. One is a set of programs that are more brick and mortar kind of programs, and the other is a set of programs that's more looking at bringing about some kind of a social consciousness and change. So there probably is an absolute need for a combination of both. With that, Mario, I'd like to come to you now. OECD has done this social institution and gender index, and 2019 index is still showing us a lot more needs to be done. And this is 25 years after Beijing. And as Nalini said that, we also have the 2030 agenda, not to mention the SDG. How do you think we will be able to bring about the major paradigm shifts that are required to specifically focus on a lot of issues that Nalini touched upon? And more so in the current context where, nations and countries globally are fighting a pandemic, there is an absolute economic slowdown, there's complete breakdown of many systems, including health, and the focus is going to be on rebuilding economies at a macro level. How is this then going to accommodate the intensive gender lens that Nalini talked about that we require to move the agenda forward?
Yes, in fact, I think that Puri has already addressed the core of the issue, so I will just pinpoint some aspects that she has so clearly and eloquently presented. First of all, let me say that it is a pleasure to be with all of you together and discuss. Yes, you are totally right. We are lagging behind and must shift gears. In fact, when we look at how things are going, the gender mainstreaming has not materialized in practice, and progress has been too slow. In general, let me take also the possibility, me too, to add my voice in celebrating the Independence Day. I belong to a generation that still have an historical memory, and for me, is moving this moment and the role that India is playing in general in the world for all countries. But say that even in India, we see that the result and despite some progresses are lagging behind. The gender objectives, unless it takes an unprecedented action to advance, will not be reached for the objective of the 2030. Women undertake 9 times more unpaid care and domestic work than men. And despite some evolving legislation, the practice of child marriage remains widespread. I will not quote number, but if you want, we can. But let's say on the legal front, for example, it's a common practice in certain communities. These remain a fact. So generally speaking, I think that mainstreaming was helpful as a logic, but we need to go in the direction that Puri has said. We need to address the root causes. And the root causes are a kind of hidden iceberg. We measure how many women are in parliament, how many are in business activities and so on. But in reality, the present condition, the performances are the result of root causes that rely in what? In what Puri said, in social institutions, in laws, in social norms, in practices. And therefore, as you said, with the COVID, what we are observing is that countries are moving in all directions, but almost systematically, they are ignoring the gender lens. And despite the gendered impacts of the pandemic has been much more than in the case of men. We must link the recovery measure with policy and programs that address underlying gender inequalities. And the whole condition will be improved. The cost to the global economy in 2017 of not tackling gender-based discrimination was estimated in $6 trillion. I'm talking of 7.5 loss of global GDP. Now, in a situation that you described clearly with the COVID crisis, where all countries have lost an enormous amount of their growth, well, this would be, of course, a crucial factor to continue and to address the problem and to try to solve. Now, if you ask me, therefore, this change of paradigm, how it should be substantiated, I think that, again, Puri has set all the pillar of a substantiation. I will summarize them in the following way. First, we need strategies. The mainstreaming is adding a lens in each policy so that at the margin, there could be also a women chapter. Maybe it's helpful for organizing advocacy, but it's not necessarily the most effective way. We need to identify where are the traps, where are the bottlenecks, and therefore this means strategies. Building through different policies, a mix of policy and the sequencing of policy, something that can address those root causes that are social norms and institutions. And we also need specific national strategies. It's obvious that social norms vary from country to country and the context matter. Therefore, pretending that we have just a solution for all is simply stupid. We did this mistake in economics. Now we see that it was a mistake. Let's not replicate the mistake now. A second dimension that Puri stressed so clearly is actors. What should be the actors now in a change of paradigm? The pandemic requires some strengthening of horizontal and multilateral cooperation. Why? We need to learn from each other. India is extraordinary in the field of South-South cooperation. The New Delhi Conference, for me, is always, every year, a very interesting event. Now, what is behind? The idea is that the South can learn from the South, the North can learn from the South, and sometimes the South can learn from the North. In other terms, we have experiences of everyday efforts to change the condition that would deserve to be shared. But unfortunately, we don't have appropriate table, either because when we have those tables are mainly used for advocacy instead of exchange of experiences and work, or because the table that exists are limited only to the donor's country, which is a paradox under my point of view, or are just limited to few countries. I am not criticizing the experience of exchanging practices. The more, the better. However, we need an appropriate table where local actors, like urban actors, rural actors, sit together with national government across countries also to learn. And I would conclude also that we need men and boys to be positive agents of change. So we need to start developing also discourse that involve a different way to be man and to be boy. Because without that component, it will be very difficult to change the social norm, obviously. And I conclude, we need better data. In the OECD Development Center, we have developed an indicator that is called SIGI, Social Institution Gender Index. It covers 180 countries, and we regularly try to identify how countries are in terms of social institution. This is an helpful tool. It's not the only one, but I think it's an helpful tool, and in fact, it's used to measure Objective 511. I think we need funds, and for that, we need more role for philanthropy. Philanthropy is, in middle-income country, an actor that is increasing in terms of importance. Moreover, it is changing way of operating. Instead of distributing funds on an ATM card basis, the philanthropy want to sit from the beginning with the ideas and be a venture philanthropist, build together idea and project. We need the role of philanthropy, and also we need to know a little bit more how much is spent, where the money goes, and start having the actor with the real weight that it should have, and up to now, it doesn't have. Let me just say, only 1% of funding from international foundation working in India, only 1% of the funds of international foundation is given to India. And 0.5 of funding from domestic Indian foundation is dedicating to gender issue. So, foundations are crucial, are important, are in crucial partner. We need also to work more with foundation and to have them more at the table. I don't know if I answered your question, but I stay here. Anyhow, Puri already said everything, so I can't
Absolutely. I think you really made some very critical point, and actually it's a very nice segue into my next question, which is actually for Pradeep, because you talked about philanthropy and your foundation. And I think the critical link is how much of what is being funded is driven by real-time data, are we getting the data, and who is bringing the data to the table? These are critical questions that are being asked globally. So with that, Pradeep, my question to you then, as you know, heading one of the oldest and one of the largest foundation, is what is the current scenario within the foundation and other multilateral, bilateral development players in terms of the kind of gender work that's been funded? What is the ask, and what exactly are we delivering?
Thank you. First of all, good to see you again, Nandita. It's been a while, and it's a pleasure to make the acquaintance of Lakshmi and Mario. I don't believe we have met before, so it's a pleasure to meet the two of you. I'd like to also thank the Nudge Foundation for putting this together. I guess only organizations like them can actually pull this off, so it's pretty impressive. And a very happy Independence Day and 15th of August to all the Indians on this call. So Nandita, I guess your question is very important. It's also a very tricky question, because it's one that I think can ruffle a few feathers depending on what I may or may not say. So I'll try to be brief, and secondly, I'll also try to avoid being too specific, I guess. So to your question, it was a very broad question also. See, I think as a foundation, Ford does have a program that's focused on women currently. And even though for the last 30 years or so, we've actually been changing our programs every 5 years or so, I think gender is one of the few programs that's consistently been something that we've been doing. Of course, the specific intervention in gender has changed every 5 years or so. For example, the work that we're doing on gender right now that started early this year, even before COVID, is focused specifically on violence against women and girls, right? In the previous program that we've done, there wasn't a specific focus on violence. It was on different issues that we thought were more important based on the time then. So that's what we focused on. And to your question on how much of this is informed by data, I'm afraid to say that, and a little embarrassed also to say, and this is where I agree with both the speakers before me, that we don't have enough good data to kind of make a strong case on why this and why not that, right? So yes, there is data based on our own research and our own collections, which may not be as quantitative as we would like, but it's more qualitative. It's based on our 70 years being based here, and a lot of other data points that have led us to this point, maybe you know, where we think this one particular intervention is more important than the other. But I think all of us are clearly agreeing, and you know, I'm almost certain this is also true for certain other regions, because we work not just in India, we work in several regions around the world, and we have this problem consistently across several regions that we don't really have clear and enough data, right? And I realize data is not static, it needs to be an ongoing thing, but we've taken that effort. So with OECD, and I'm sure Mario knows about this project, we actually embarked on a project 2 years ago to collect data just on this. That we in our office actually set about, and I think some of the numbers that you might have quoted, I think came out of that a very low percentage of Indian foundations actually make grants in this area and in India, right? So I think Nandita, the first answer to your question is, we don't have enough data for me to convincingly say this is based on so and so data that we've decided to do this. I don't have that data to kind of say that. Having said that, we've decided that we need to create that kind of data, and we've made an effort, like I said, with several grants to OECD and a few other organizations, to collect data overall in philanthropy, but specifically focus on gender, right? So that's the first part of your question. But overall as a foundation, and this doesn't apply only to India, overall as a foundation, Nandita, we've decided last year, you know, what we restructured our work globally for foundation. We said that rather than doing a lot of different things, which is what we used to do till about 2 years ago, let's just focus on a few things globally, right? And then in each of the regions, we pick which of those things we want to do and really do a deep dive on it. And I should say that gender obviously was the first thing that everyone said we got to work on, right? Globally as an organization, and we picked two other things. And within gender then, you know, each of the offices decided this is the specific intervention that we would like. And our office, like I shared with you, decided to work on violence against women and girls. Our work, and I suspect the work of several other organizations and foundations in India, is not necessarily informed by enough data to tell you why we should work in one thing versus the other. Having said that, I think there are enough surveys having been done in India, a few of them, whether it's by the National Family Health Surveys or, you know, the Crime Records Bureau, that shows that violence against women is a real thing, right? We all know that, but there's enough data to show, and some of them, and again, depends on who's collecting the data and, you know, and who's reading it and who's interpreting it and all of that. So I don't want to go into, and I don't want to get it stuck in, so this is the data and this is not, but it shows a very, very, very high prevalence of violence in daily life women face in India, and the two other countries that we work off out of India are Nepal and Sri Lanka. It's not much different in Nepal and Sri Lanka also, right? These three countries that we work in all show a very high rate of violence in daily life. It also shows whether it's unequal access to education opportunities, unequal access to employment. This is just the access part of it, right? Then post that, there is also, you know, what prevents them from continuing education, continuing employment, and so on and so forth, right? So the violence and the fear of violence that women face prevents, leads to a lot of inequality issues that all of us are aware of. The paucity of data, you know, comes to haunt us in a lot of different ways. And we tell that from experience. When you're actually trying to convince other donors and foundations and making a strong case on why they need to do gender-specific programs and invest in it. Like Mario said, you can make a strong case also on the economic piece of it. Like I think he gave very good numbers about the GDP and contribution and so on and so forth. We don't even go there. I mean, just even using evidence that if you are in foundation, if you really want to bring about societal change, right, which is what a lot of organizations in philanthropy aim to do, then it makes, in all sense, whether, you know, however you slice the data, I mean, women are an integral part of it, right? And we have enough literature to show that investing in a women, right? We hear about all these stories, and I'm sure Nandita, I think you also, your organization also works on some of these. Investing in a women has more, does more to the family than investing in any other member of the family, and so on and so forth, right? But in spite of the societal benefit, I'm not even talking about the economic part of it. It's such a difficult job convincing other foundations and donors in the region to kind of really not just have a gender lens, forget about gender lens, but actually, having strong gender programs. We've not really understood why, but our solution to this has been that A, we need to collect more data, as much as data as possible, but B, we are also intentionally going out and trying to form these collaboratives and partnerships with other founders and donors, saying that let's do this together because, you know, maybe the hesitation that some of you have is that you don't really understand the space all that well. You're concerned about, you know, how do you measure outcomes and so on and so forth, right? So we've said maybe the approach that we need to take as a foundation that's been here for a long time is actually form some of these collaboratives, right? And say, let's do this together, right? And together, maybe at the end of it, end of the 2-3 year program, hopefully you'll be better informed on, you know, how to then do this by yourself. So that's one of the approaches that we have taken, besides, of course, being in several panels and so on and so forth. So I think just in summary, the two things that we are doing to address, Nandita, what we think is an acute shortage of enough foundations working in this. One is collecting more data and evidence. And the second is actually strongly forming more and more collaboratives and networks to do this work jointly with other foundations.
Nandita,
thank you so much,
if I may,
yes.
I think that what Pradeep has told us now is crucial. In other terms, foundational crucial, but we need leader like Ford is playing now to put together the other as well and follow those directions that Pradeep has said. Sorry to interrupt.
No, that's fine. No, that's important. And I think, you know, I'm basically going to have some leading questions from what all three of you said. And critically, I think, starting with what, Lakshmi, you put down very clearly about the, you know, absence of really focused programs, having that agency of women and boys, and then followed by what Mario, you said about the fact that, you know, mainstreaming has become a process without a strategy is not going to work. You can say mainstream, but if you don't have a focused strategy, it's not going to work. And that brings to the point where Pradeep said that there is an absence of data. And the fact that there is data, but it's probably not collated in a way that makes sense to a foundation or a funder or a person who's going to put their money on certain issues, because there's always this thing about, okay, what's the value for the dollar that I'm putting, kind of question that always comes up. I'm going to turn to you, Lakshmi, now. And the question that is related from this is that one of the biggest challenges also been getting the women's movement, who is in the center of delivering programs, be it on SGV, GVV, domestic violence. You know, they're so engrossed in the delivery process that their skills and capacity to actually use their programming to collect data and effectively then, influence those who can put the money or the resources is sometimes missing. I don't see enough investment going to build that skill and capacity of women's organization and institutions in a way that it's not just the foundations and the funders who are collecting the data, but people who are in the forefront. How do we empower them through whatever program they're doing to be able to collate that in numbers and the impact, you know, and understand that. And I know it's always seen as a chore saying, you know, but we have already helped so many women. But you know, the bottom line is people ask for numbers and they ask, what is it going to impact? What's my dollar going to, especially if you're looking at private philanthropies and foundations. How do you see that work progressing? What do you think we can do to really empower groups and institutions to understand the need for collecting data in a certain manner, in a certain way?
So I think, first of all, since we started talking about what the government can do, the first thing that the governments, we have been working, I mean, many years, is to get the government statistical offices and authorities and their army of, statisticians and data analysts to, you know, gender mainstream their data work. That's the first thing. And then to work very closely, you're absolutely right. Women's organizations, as you said, are so immersed in their day-to-day work that they need to be trained and they need to be provided specific and targeted resources to work on the data side of it. Because that's important for design of programs, but also the implementation, effective implementation and monitoring. So these are, and what is the before after impact of any program? You can only know if you have this kind of data. But I want to also address two other issues that came up. One is that from both Pradeep and Mario, and what you have been saying, it has to be an all of government approach for the success of this. And which means that it's not only the Ministry of Women's Affairs that must be working on it, but all the ministries have to contribute, have to prioritize this, and all the agencies. So it's whether it is the statistical bureau or whether it is. So we had been actually working very closely. They then set up separate, you know, offices, etc. So all of government approach, all of society approach. And that's where women's organizations, men and boys organizations, I think the reference was made by Mario to that. So the all of society approach means that women's organizations and all the other civil society and foundations must maintain and adopt this and embrace this cause. And the third thing that I wanted to say very much is what Mario said about COVID and the impact of COVID on women and how differential, how they have been impacted differentially and disproportionately, but also how they have been in the front line in so many areas, including health. Yeah, 70% in India, 70% of the healthcare workforce is women, and they have been out there. So I think we do need to have a very clear mainstreaming of women in terms of not only the health sector, but in terms of the disaster response and humanitarian response context. So that's something, and certainly COVID-19 related strategies have to put women at the center, both as, how they are being affected, how to mitigate, how to use their empowerment to revive and move on. And I've written a lot about this recently. So certainly this is something very important.
Thank you. On that, again, Mario, I'm coming back to you, taking from the COVID thing. You know, countries globally have announced various kind of stimulus packages to address COVID, whether you're talking about taxation benefits, startups, entrepreneurship, loans. Unfortunately, I think the ones that I've studied within South Asia, very few of them have a very defined gender lens to the stimulus package, right? It's talking about, just in generic numbers. What we do realize, though, that as you yourself said, that women are disproportionately being impacted by this for variety reasons, for traditional patriarchy to overall health, to even the loss in livelihoods. What is it that can be done to get governments to turn this gender lens into the stimulus packages, you know, in a way that it gives the space for women themselves to take advantage, and further, it provides benefits for those who are actually creating space for women. I mean, if it's an enterprise which is led by men, but it says, I'm going to put 50% women in this, is there going to be some kind of a special percentage point in a loan that he gets for that? Similarly, if it's an enterprise for women, what is it? What is it that we could do to make this happen?
Yeah, we are doing a little bit of the same thing that you are doing. We are tracking the policy that have been put in place across all developing countries, Latin America, Africa, Asia, Southeast Asia, and so on, to figure out what is going on. And to be very frank, in many cases, in the program, you don't see the gender issue, as I stated already before. But on the other hand, I cannot generalize. There are cases of measure that have been put in place where there is a focus, or at least the emphasis given to women. For example, non-conditional cash transfer, more and more, the government agree that it needs to be given to women, because that's the guarantee to have the maximum impact of these funds. I think we need to continue this work and collect this experience across countries. Now, if we want to address the big issue, which is what will happen, not now with a measure to deal immediately with the health condition, which is the most important, obviously, because we need to save life, nor with what is required in order to make the economy to survive. But if we want to address the mid-long-term recovery strategy, that will be the real issue. There we need, again, what we have said. I think we need to operate at all level of government, as Puri said. But to do that, it's not just enough to have somebody that recall in each sectoral policy what should be introduced in order to give a gender flavor to the traditional sectoral measures. We need a strategy. Therefore, probably at the level of prime minister, in any case of gender of center of government, to push the general strategy. And to do that, we need a narrative. And the narrative cannot be just an advocation strategy. In other terms, we need to put numbers, numerotical discourses, because Minister of Finance are numerotical in nature, and therefore we need to put on table some numbers that shows the mistake that there is behind this neglect. At the same time, this data have a problem. Why? A friend of mine, the chief statistician of the OECD, used to say, measure what you care and not care what you measure. We have care for years, the GDP, thinking that it was the measure of development, but it was not. And we realize now what it means in terms of gender and other things. So we need to construct statistics that are part of a coherent narrative with government. I don't see any other means immediately than having national plans. Because to have a general discourse that fits everybody, I don't think can be created in the appropriate time. So we need desperately serious national strategy plan defended in the center of government by a constituency, yeah, but it is capable to put together a narrative that makes sense. This would be my suggestion for the midterm.
Thank you. Pradeep, I'm going to take the same question to you, but also ask you to say, in relation to, you know, talking about strategy, and, you know, you talked about trying to bring in different foundations, like-minded people to address the issue of gender, and especially now that we are all dealing with this pandemic and the economic fallout on women, as we are all seeing globally, is going to be huge. Besides, of course, the health, which also is going to have economic impacts. Do you see that there would be any change in the way some of the programmings that were earlier more generally focused? For example, I mean, even say if you're working on violence against women, is that, or you're working on sexual and gender-based violence, are those programs going to start looking at the stronger link or the impact with the economic downturn and how that's changed? And is there going to be a strategic change in the way funding for that comes, or is that going to be a challenge?
No, I think there is a, so I think a question about how that this particular crisis, right, that has been building up slowly, but kind of accentuated because of, the COVID crisis. I guess your question is, will this lead to any shifts in strategy moving forward, right? Obviously, I think it's obvious, right? I mean, you don't need me to say that it's obvious, but what I would like to pick from your question is actually focus on one specific, very interesting trend that we have seen coming out of this crisis, besides the economic, which I think the economic thing necessarily is not a result, has not necessarily come up out of this crisis, in my opinion. It's been leading up to this, right? It's always been happening. And it's just that this maybe has accentuated it. But for us, one interesting trend that has come out of this specific crisis, which we were kind of aware of, but has really not truly made it, advanced it, is the whole, coming back to what I was reminding you of what it is that we do, which is violence against women and girls. For us, and the way we define it is violence against women and girls in public spaces. Right? That's an area that we are very interested in. And we've been working because we're saying, yes, domestic violence is something that people talk about, but how do we define public spaces? What is public space, right? And is it mobility? Is it, you know, just out in the open? Is it workplace, whatever? So, but for us, I think the one thing that has come out of this is even our rethinking of public space to include the digital and online sphere also. Something that we had not, I mean, we were kind of aware of that, and we were working on it. But I think this particular crisis for us, look at what we're doing right now, right? Having this conversation digitally, online, everything is now digital, right? It has just completely advanced everyone's plans. So to your question, I think, Nandit, that's a major shift we're going to see moving forward. So I think most gender programs, whether they like it or not, are going to have to consider this as part of their, you know, what does that mean? So if you're working on violence, for example, against women, for us, it's already made us rethink about a public space being also digital. Because most of the public space for us now, a majority of it, at least for the next few months or the years, is going to be not the public space like how we've been used to, but it's going to be the digital space. That's going to be the public space. That's where women are going to go to work. That's where women are going to go to get their public benefits from the government. That's where women are going to get educated. That's where women are going to get to be part of forums and groups. A lot of things, that's going to be the public space. And in this, and again, you don't need me to tell you this, Nandita, is that the digital divide that exists in the country across the genders is very, very stark, right? Just with some very conservative numbers we've found, and this is just through some programs that we have done, right? And we can, of course, extrapolate this data to say maybe it can be for a larger population, but just very small data sample collection that we have show that about 90% of smartphone access, smartphones are owned and accessed by men or boys and not by women and girls, right? So, if that's the reality and moving forward, you can imagine if tomorrow the government or any of the foundations wants to deploy something through digital space, it's going to be unequal access, right? Because majority of the consumers of that data will be men and boys and not the women. So when you're saying that, you know, moving forward, if you want to apply for any public benefits, any social benefits, filing, you know, getting food rations and all that, you have to go on digitally. But guess what? Digitally, you know, it's mostly men who have the access. You can see how this thing just, you know, plays out. There's so much of, I guess, inequality is waiting to happen. That for us, I think this is something that we've been trying to figure out how to do it. And to be very honest, if you don't know, we're not there yet, right? We're also trying to figure out the strategy. We're working with our partners, requesting their help to inform us better on this. Everyone is trying to, you know, I guess, learn as you, as this unfolds before us. And I'll just end by just a very, and for me at least, I just find it very amusing and sadly so, but I'm trying to make light of the situation. In that, two things, right? One, of course, is how, you know, we all say that violence is happening, you know, this gender inequality is happening, and especially has been accentuated during this COVID crisis, right? I think that's one thing that all of us on this panel are agreeing for not just in India, but globally. But it's striking that if you ask people what are the one or two issues that they think COVID has, you know, brought up in the last 6 months, at least in India, everyone talks about migrant crisis. Right, workers' crisis, and I'm not saying it's not an issue, but it just shows how people's, you know, perception of what the real issues are so much colored by the narratives and what we talk about, right? Because migrants issue, is it concerning? Yes, but if you ask me, is it purely going by numbers, right? Is it more or less than the gender inequality? It's much, much less than the gender numbers that we are talking about. But it just shows how the narratives are so strongly formed that we don't even think about gender issue as an issue during this crisis, when, like I said, right from the digital to violence, everything shows that it has affected women unequally. That's one. The second thing, and this is purely please just take it for what it is. It's on a very light note, but I am, you know, when we talk about rolling out some of these things, let's say if you really care about these digital space being important and saying, how do we address issues like making sure that women have access to things that they need in this crisis, I find it very striking and amusing that we are all, and this is not less to do with the government and more to do with us as a society and the corporate and the private sector, that we seem to be more, you know, interested in whether alcohol will be rolled out as something that corporates or private sector can home deliver, has been a topic of conversation over the last 6 months, much more than really, you know, like I said, like an issue like, wait a minute, can we really make sure that people are getting access to important things digitally or online, right? Like I said, whether it's food or whatever, but we all seem to be, and for those of you in India, I'm sure you all know what I'm talking about when I say the headlines continuously are, wait a minute, can we actually have alcohol delivered to us online? And this is, again, nothing to do with government. This is a private sector, you know, that's trying to figure this out. But again, this just shows how, unless you have this continuous narrative to remind people of what are things that are important and things that we all need to care about, it's so easy to get distracted by all the other things going out there.
Absolutely. I think, you know, interesting that you're talking about the digital divide and the digital opportunity. It's both, I think. What's also happened, as you're rightly pointing out, in the new normal, the economy has also gone gig, Yeah, it's really made, whether it's your things being delivered home, whether it's your big baskets, or, you know, whether it's your BTGOs or whatever, the Amazons. It's also, what was interesting is, you know, like you, we also work in this area a lot. And we actually, before COVID stuck, we did a kind of a baseline quick research to understand what's happening with one of our major gig platforms in India. I'm not going to take names. And we found out that they had an exponentially high number of women gig workers in that platform. But the kind of services or the sectors that they were engaged in were largely personal grooming, training, beauty culture. Now, when COVID hit, these were the first people to lose their jobs, right? Now, the gig economy picked up, and a lot of the people, men in the who are working in the gig sector, whether it be Uber or Urban Clap, were able to somewhat switch from one to the other, depending on where the opportunity was. But that didn't happen for women. So, Lakshmi, I wanted to ask you, do you see, going forward, as Pradeep pointed out, we are going to get more and more into this new normal of a more digitized space. And there are two aspects to it. One, when women enter the digital space, their safety and security, because they're at two levels. One, in the virtual space itself, the chances of getting abused, harassed. But when a virtual platform takes you to physical spaces, people's houses, to jobs, then where are those challenges? What checks and balances are there? At this point, very little. What can we do to enhance that? And secondly, the related question, and this is just opening up to everybody because I have just a few minutes, the kind of financial resources, skills training, etc., that will now need to be done in a focused way to ensure that women are able to take equal access and equal opportunity and benefit from this digitized space that we are opening up. So to Lakshmi, the first to you, and then you can answer the second a bit, and then we'll, Mario, Pradeep, either of you or both. Yeah.
No, in fact, I would like to begin with recalling that at some point, UN Women entered into a partnership with Uber that they would train 5,000 drivers in certain countries, in each country, and enable them to be part of the Uber drivers force. And then we got so much grief from women's movement, from ILO, and from all the labor unions that we had to drop that partnership. So why I'm telling you this is that at one point, from the women's rights and labor rights points of view, there was, this was a gig economy and gig work, because it was flexible, because it was temporary, because it had no social protection, and labor standards were not being followed. So this was stigmatized. But I think what COVID has done is it has accelerated and fast-tracked our going into that gig space and digital workspace quite ahead of time. You're rightly saying that women were in some of these gig areas, but during COVID, I think they were not that much, and they cannot be that much there, for example, in delivery services, which it really got a very big push during the gig economy got a real push during, in terms of the delivery services. Now, if you look at it objectively, digital work, flexible work arrangements, and working from home has been something that women have preferred, many women have preferred, particularly those of childbearing age and those who are wanting to combine work with staying at home. And that was stigmatized. It was seen as something that women seek to do. Now you see a legitimization of that in one way. So that's one positive. But also then there is the question is, the other positive is that once it gets regularized and normalized, digital work, it provides women better opportunities to combine working from home with a regular job, and which you know, for which they don't have to pay the motherhood penalty, they don't have to suffer the leaking pipeline issue of not being able to re-enter if they take leave and not being able to be promoted because they have been away. So I think this is something which is positive. But then there are the some negatives that we also, you have referred to them, but one of them is, of course, work in offices was something that provided women opportunities for networking, socializing, and working in a team. And it was, in any case, a very enriching and empowering experience. And what I fear is there might be a stereotyping of women working from home, and they may not get these kind of opportunities. Then there is the
Lakshmi, I'm sorry.
Digital gap, and because of which they may be disenfranchised from these new areas. So these are some of the issues. And
Lakshmi, last, I have 1 minute. I'm sorry.
Skills and safety issues. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm sorry, Pradeep and Mario. I don't think we'll have time to put the question to you. I've already been warned there's a minute left. I think critical questions have been asked, and some of it we have answered, but this is going to be a much larger debate and a much larger discourse, which will really require a very large concerted effort by all of us who are key players, and you know, and expand the circle of those we work with, including the private sector and the government, and create the opportunities to take advantage of whatever the new normal is going to be, but definitely do it with a focused gender lens. This has been very enriching. I really want to thank all the three absolutely amazing speakers who were with us in the panel. A big thank you to you all for joining. Again, a very happy Independence Day to all Indian friends, to all. And Pooja, over to you. And thank you, Nudge, for having provided us this platform and nudging us to think differently. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nandita. Thank you, all the panelists. It was actually a great pleasure to listen to and understand the importance of different approaches to interventions around gender issues. Women empowerment, followed by some other influencing issues. I absolutely loved the discussion around the role of data, governmental strategies, policies, and how it can make such interventions more effective. Thanks a lot, everyone, for joining us.